Are you missing your goals? Do you feel stuck and unmotivated? It could be your desk setup that's sabotaging your productivity. This is my most productive desk setup and the workflows that help to keep me outperforming my peers. Hi, I'm Bill Rice, founder and entrepreneur with 20 plus years as an agency owner. On this channel, I help entrepreneurs level up by sharing my experiences through strategy, productivity tips, gear and reviews, and the books that helped me. In this video, I want to show you my most productive desk setup to date. All right, let's start with the computer. I have switched to the new M4 iMac, and this has been really liberating in a lot of different ways. It's incredibly fast. It handles all of my tasks without a single hitch. I moved from an actual MacBook Air where I had the M1 chip. So from that standpoint, it's not a ton of performance upgrade, but it's substantial and it's noticeable for sure. But the most important thing is it gives me kind of an all-in-one screen with plenty of real estate. Outproduces, of course, my 13-inch MacBook Air. I still have my second screen, but I love the clarity and all of the real estate on my primary screen, which is the iMac monitor, the kind of all-in-one. The other thing that's very nice and certainly noticeable, and hopefully you'll notice a little bit of this, is the camera, the microphone, and the speakers are all inherent and are of a top quality. So I was able to kind of toss out my MacBook Air kind of wonky setup, my Shure microphone, the iPhone I was using to actually capture my videos, my Insta360 camera that I was using. All of these things sort of got discarded so that I can have a quick and easy setup to record these videos and do all the other sort of video content that I'm doing for LinkedIn and short form and those sorts of things. So I left all of those things behind. I'm a big fan and increasingly focused on simplifying my workflows. As things get busy, simpler it is, the more singular the solution is, so you can sit down and just get to work without a lot of extra accessories and distractions. It is certainly a big win. So number two, software. Same sort of theme here, less is more. So when it comes to software, simplicity is the key. Understanding exactly where I go to start working and a place in which everything that I need to be productive is there and at my fingertips, all the source material, all the content and resources and research that I've collected is sort of there and ready for me to do the work is so important, particularly since I focus and work in strategy. So I'm often collecting and curating and researching and pulling all that together in order to turn it into a strategic deliverable or product. So what do I do in order to do that? Well, everything starts in Notion. Literally, as I start my day, I pull up Notion. I go into my project management system. Everything's built on databases, but I go in there and I go into that particular task or project and I begin working within that page construct. This is where I'm putting stuff in, adding material, reviewing the material that I have, linking off to resources. So many things embed really well. So if I'm using a video or building video content, and maybe I want to have some examples of other videos in there that I'm looking at, I'm being inspired by, or quite honestly, I'm competing with, that's really effective. Same thing with Google Docs and stuff like that. Maybe I'm pulling in a spreadsheet. I'm also using another Google Doc. Maybe I've pulled in something I've used in the past, or I'm searching the database and I want to link through that. It makes all that super efficient. Then, sort of related to that, and this tool works in and out of Notion, is ChatGPT. So ChatGPT is where I'm doing a lot of my ideation, my brainstorming. One of my favorite use cases is to give it a role. That could be an ICP that I want to approach, could be an expert that I want to interview so that I'm learning something from that domain. It could be an industry I want to approach. It could be a role that I'm looking to approach. It could be potentially a reader or an audience that I want to reach. And so I give ChatGPT that role and I interview and I work with and I challenge and I ask questions of ChatGPT in the context of that role. The other thing, of course, I do is to help refine it, maybe make different versions of things One of my favorites is to kind of build, in the context of YouTube, I build out a video script, or maybe there's a document that I'm putting together, a piece of strategy. I'm literally writing as quickly as possible, bullet points, sort of free writing. A lot of people have heard of that concept, where I'm not trying to edit myself. I'm just kind of pouring out every single thought that comes. And instead of refining it, which I would do before, and I'd spend a lot of time sort of refining it, sort of crafting the perfect phrases and sentences and all that stuff, I'm literally just dumping as quickly as possible. In some cases, I'm actually just doing voice to text, right? I turn on and I dictate into ChatGPT some things that I'm working on or to Notion. And then I take those notes and I put them into ChatGPT and I say, hey, help me to organize and to create something from these notes, and it'll give me a rough draft. And what it does really well is it starts to organize things, it refines things, it blows out certain concepts, and then I will iterate through that, having a conversation. Again, another common use case for me in ChatGPT is to sort of coach ChatGPT, much like I would a junior strategist or an employee. As they're kind of showing me things, I would coach through additional iterations of it, and ChatGPT functions really well in that capacity. Then the other piece of software that I use, and this is often where final deliverables go, is I will refine it into Google Docs or Google Sheet or Google Slides. And really, the only reason that I move to that is just because it's more accessible to clients, right? Almost everybody seems to be on this type of platform or can read from those documents, or I can cleanly export to Word or PowerPoint or those other formats, or just export to PDF and deliver a clean deliverable. So that's one of the reasons, and probably the only reason, that I move kind of from Notion into the Google platform there, just again, for accessibility. The other place that sort of final drafts sometimes go, or that I'm doing ideation, is inside of Figma, specifically FigJam. So I love popping on there, using boxes and flowcharts and sort of crafting out, diagramming things, particularly workflows or campaign flows and those sorts of things. It's a great place to just put some boxes and put some context and connections for those. And so FigJam is another tool that I use quite frequently. So that is kind of deliverables. That's thinking, that's ideation, that's deliverables. And then, of course, the other piece of what I do is, of course, communicate with the team and communicate externally. So I'm using Loom for most of that. So communicating even with the team, it's easier for me to kind of show what I'm thinking or ideate through my computer screen instead of hopping them on a call and doing a screen share. A lot of times Loom is much more effective. And then the actual communicating often happens through Slack. In the case of course, clients and those sorts of things, I'm going to move through Google Meet or something like that. Probably a little too impersonal to just toss them a Loom video, although it'd probably be pretty effective. And then the last piece of software that I'm using is a layer of project management. I love Notion and the ability to kind of build out databases and tasks inside of there. It's becoming easier and easier. You can do reoccurring tasks. You can automate things and notifications. So it's really easy for me to build out a database with all of the things that need to get done, and then to move them around Kanban board or something like that. So that becomes my project management as well. All right, the last area of kind of my productivity as it relates to my desk is the analog tools that I use. And so despite most of my business being digital, digital marketing, running digital marketing agencies, doing B2B and B2C lead generation strategy, I love going back to analog. And so I'm famous for kind of talking about my three notebook system here. There is one notebook that is kind of this horizontal orientation, and it lays right underneath my keyboard. Specifically, as I'm working throughout the day, you kind of have this set up here. So I'm working digitally, But oftentimes I've got a scratch pad going down here. The other thing that this notebook works really well for, and again, I'll link all this stuff up in the description, but and it's kind of an unusual and specific orientation. It allows you to sort of title things, and it gives kind of this sort of orientation here. Really effective for also taking notes on calls, right? So as I'm taking notes or as I'm doing a sales call or discovery call, there's a couple of things that are going on that makes this really powerful. So one, I wanna make sure that I'm listening intently to everything that's going on. And most of the time with discovery calls and demo calls, strategy calls, I'm spending most of my time asking questions, often about known patterns. Like I've seen a lot of this stuff, 20 plus years doing it. I've already seen most of the different sort of situations, use cases, and patterns that I'm likely to see. So most of my time is spent asking questions and listening to the client sort of explain through their experience. By having a pad of paper in front of me, it allows me to one, hold my tongue, and to two, to show that I'm intent in capturing and listening to what they're saying. So a lot of times when I'll have thoughts, it's really easy with anyone with a lot of experience to sort of prematurely go in and diagnose the problem without sort of listening to the full set of symptoms. And so the paper in front of me allows me to contain myself, to make notes of things that I might be thinking, to make notes of things that seem to fit into a certain pattern, and then allow the client to fully express themselves before I hop back into the conversation. The other notebook is the journal. And so I've done a couple of different iterations of this. In the past, I was a big fan of the Lockbee journal for a lot of reasons. You can pack this thing full of stuff. You can put multiple notebooks in it. And I've got a video on this. I still like this, but what I have found lately is it's just easier to have a notebook that I can beat up. Kind of like the fact that I could beat it up a little bit, toss it in my bag, and then pull it out. One of the disadvantages is, if you've seen my video on Sam Altman's system, I'm a big fan of kind of tearing out pages and using those pieces and parts and organizing and stacking them. And so, of course, those potentially will fall out if I'm not careful. So, but that journal is specifically for me to have some dedicated time to work through very specific, more complex projects or journal about my day or some things that I'm thinking through or wrestling through. I'm not much of a diarist. So a lot of times this is what I often refer to as my thinking journal. So when I'm in this, I'm thinking deeply about a particular project or problem. This is my pocket journal, and this is the journal that I use specifically in the context of Sam Altman's system of pocket journal. So there's a couple of things that are important here. One, this is just for quick capture of things, and then my ultimate goal will be to tear most of these pages out and move them into some digital format that allows me to do much more with them. But it's compact, it's easy to use. I like the plain paper, and this is a good quality paper. So I can even do watercolors and sketches and stuff. So I also like to do watercolors. And then the hardest part is to find a pen that will slide in here that you still like to write with. This is the Muji. The other thing that sometimes I put in here is this Sharpie rollerball. So that could be a really ideal thing, or the classic sort of Uniball. All those work in that. So you do have to find something kind of narrow like this. This isn't perfect because I'm a big fan of sort of the Pilot G2, or this is a little bit of a hack. And I talk about Pilot G2 being my go-to writer, or it will in this, but this little Amazon Basic is pretty darn good. I like the clickable, but it does not necessarily, because of some of the ergonomics of this and the Pilot G2, doesn't really work there. So don't love that. Okay. And the last thing that I'll talk about as far as productivity on my desk setup is, what do you use to get yourself in the mindset or in kind of that focused mood to work on your projects without distraction? So the bad thing about sort of having a digital job and being on your computer is you have ready access to social media, to YouTube videos, which obviously is a weakness for me. But some of the things that have helped me is when I'm getting ready to go into an intense work session or a dedicated work session is to specifically go to YouTube, or you can do this on Apple Music as well, and use lo-fi hip hop, binaural beats, classical music, or even classic rock. And I use classic rock because I know all of it. I know all the words. I know all the beats. It's very familiar to me. So figuring out some way to put around you some background noise that will kind of get your environment in the context of heavy thinking, but not distract you at the same time. And some of those, like I said, the lo-fi, hip-hop, those binaural beats are really kind of interesting. So the binaural beats specifically, and I don't know all the science, I probably should have researched that a little bit before this video, but it does some sequencing from right to left that sort of kind of keeps you in a focused sort of state, and use some science behind the rhythms and the sounds that you hear and those sorts of things. But the super, super effective whenever I kind of turn that on, and I'm not a big headphone wearer or even a music person. I like to use it in the gym, but something about kind of putting that in the background really does get your brain focused in on your task and makes you highly productive. So what makes you productive? How do you stay on task? Share with me some of the tips in the comments below. If you found this helpful, of course, don't forget to like and subscribe. Hit the notification bell so that you can get more insights on leveling up your entrepreneurial journey. Look forward to seeing you in the next one.